Okay, hello everyone. So I'm Nizar, Romdan, CEO and co-founder of Virtual Arts. So Virtual Arts, we're a bunch of guys from Cambridge, UK. I guess if you've been to Cambridge, probably you have experienced punting on the river. We decided it was a cool and fun idea to wear some virtual reality headsets and go take some photos on the river. So we are a group of two core teams. The first is from Arm, the processor company, also based in Cambridge. And the second one is from Sony, Guerrilla, Cambridge, so the studio that was part of Sony PlayStation. We started the company in December last year, and as of today, we are 11 guys, so 5 from Arm, 6 from Sony. Together, we worked on more than 20 games or game prototypes. The Sony guys worked on titles like Little Big Planet, Killzone Mercenary for PlayStation Vita and PSP, and more recently, Rigs, the virtual reality launch title for PlayStation VR. So I thought, show you what we do. I mean, we are VR and AR startup. So we do two things, mobile content, and we do also technology. On the content front, we make games, but also we make experiences and as well animations, all in VR and AR. And the tech front, we develop our own engine and tool chains to develop that, because we believe to do great VR and AR, we have to be in control of the tech we make. So some of the things we worked on a real while back. Oh, no sound. I thought we tested sound earlier. Sorry. No. Okay. Sorry about that. We'll have to see them without the sound. So this was an augmented reality game that we developed back in 2012, when augmented reality was like in the beginning of the hype. The principle was quite simple. It was tag-based. AR back then was mainly tag-based. AR now with the recent AR kit is thriving to be without tags, so tagless. And the principle was you have to guide a laser source from, from source to targets, using some mirrors and prisms to solve certain puzzles. And it was running on the Galaxy S2 back then, so which was quite a capable smartphone in 2012, but today that's considered almost like quite old compared to the current platforms. And despite of that, we were able to create a quite nice and compelling game demo. It was called Magic Mirrors. It's much better with the sound. Sorry about that. And yeah, the whole point is that you manage to get them until the target and to solve the puzzle. It was very interactive and fun to play. So that was what we did in 2012 to prove that we can do augmented reality. Then we had to go at virtual reality back in the early years when the Gear VR was in kind of developer prototype mode. This was called Ice Cave VR. And it was run entirely in mobile, and we had mirroring the screen to a second screen. So it's quite a tech demo to showcase that you can achieve quite high fidelity visuals on mobile on the Gear VR. It was all about the Rift, the Vive, so the PC and console versions, but we wanted to prove that actually mobile VR can do it as well. And we were mirroring to second screen so that people around the player can also look and watch what the player is doing.
I don't know why there's no sound.
Oops. Okay. And then the Sony guys, of course, welcome very. Oh, that's much better.
All hands on the trigger, all eyes on the gun. Don't believe that we're strong enough to hold on. Cause I'm the only one to get you, the only one to figure you out. You're a place that I can go to, a place that couldn't live without. And nobody sees what we do. Don't need anybody else around. No matter what they told us, gravity will hold us down. Oh, 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 oh. Even gravity can hold us. Oh, 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 oh. Even gravity can hold us down. Oh, 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 oh. Even gravity can hold us down.
That was Riggs that launched late last year, and the guys from Sony that joined us worked on that title, which was a launch title for PlayStation VR. So why did we decide to focus on VR and AR? I guess you guys probably know it since you're in this room, but it's pitched to be the next big thing if you consider maybe PC, internet, then mobile, as the next big things when they happened. So we wanted to be really in an exciting domain. The challenging thing when you join a new thing or the next big thing is whether it is happening right now or is it going to happen in 5 years or 10 years. This is the typical technology hype curve where most new technologies go through. You have quite a phase that's really exciting, everyone jumps on board. You reach the peak and then disillusion. People thought more maybe what can be done within a few years, and then generally you have like a dive, investors run away, lots of people leave, it's not delivering, lots of frustrations. Then somehow it reaches what is perceived the bottom and then starts taking off again to what the technology will be. Where you want to be is actually when the technology has gone through the hype and starting to be more delivering. And this is actually from Gartner, the famous analyst, and they see VR now has gone past that and now in a stable curve. AR is about to get into that, and this was from July, so probably after the announcement of the iPhone 8 and iPhone 10 from Apple, it's getting AR as well to that curve. So we were quite deliberately waiting for that hype cycle to go, and that's why we decided to launch the studio late last year, then maybe 2 or 3 years before that. It's great news if you're in VR and AR, because the tough part probably has passed, and it should be hopefully good or easier for everyone coming on board. So it's time to join VR and AR. The other thing also, we decided to focus where we believe mass market will be. And we believe a lot in mobile. So this is from DigiCapital, also an analyst, and they predict that the installed base for VR and AR headsets in 2022 exceed 500 million units. And you can see most of that will be mobile. Of course, AR by definition is mobile, but most of the VR headsets as well that will dominate will be mobile. The other info that we carry probably maybe from our Arm days, this was the last public report from Arm before its acquisition by SoftBank. And this is their prediction in terms of smartphone sales in 2020. And you can see that there will be more than 2 billion smartphones selling every year in 2020. If you add to that the tablets, nearly 500 million. And you can see that there's three categories. The entry level are really the cheap smartphones that sell less than $100. The mid-range, probably between $100 and $200. And the premium is probably anything above $300, it's getting even more than $400 and $500 mark. The interesting thing is that the entry level will be selling at more than $1 billion. So it's a vast, massive opportunity. We see this is really the future, because augmented reality is inherently mobile, but then mobile-based VR will allow us to access this market. The entry-level smartphones are not really underpowered devices, because a rule of thumb you can follow to predict the performance of new smartphones. What was the high-end kind of smartphone this year will almost become mid-range the year after, and then the entry level a year after that. So 2 to 3 years before you see the performance of the high smartphone in the entry level. So in 2020, that means the phones of this year, so like the iPhone maybe 8, the Galaxy S8 kind of performance, that's what will be the entry level smartphone of 2020, the phone that you can buy at less than $100. So 1 billion of these will be selling in 2020 with the capabilities of almost like the smartphone of this year. So it's a huge, huge opportunity. That's why we decided to focus on mobile for both VR and AR. So on mobile VR fronts, we focus on Gear VR, Daydream, Cardboard, and the newly announced World Sense from Google. And in China, because we work quite a lot with Chinese partners, which is something we carry probably from our ARM days, the largest players, Deepon and Pico, they are the equivalent of the Gear VR and maybe the Daydream of China. And then Nibiru, which is like an aggregator of more than 50 different players in mobile. They have a variation of both VR headsets that are based on a phone, so you plug the phone in them, or you have the all-in-one standalone mobile VR headset that doesn't require a phone. It has everything inside, the screen, the processor, the battery, everything. On the AR front, so we focus on all AR platforms. The standard ones, which is basically based on standard cameras, that's the normal smartphones and tablets that sell nowadays, or the specialized ones, so based on depth cameras like Project Tango from Google. You can argue that the iPhone 10 probably falls into that category since it has special depth sensor. And then we'll be looking also into the mixed reality kind of sound of things when these headsets become more available. The hotly anticipated Magic Leap headset, of course, but things like the HoloLens and others when they become more available. So since we started, we've been working on our first game, which is called Cargo Racing VR. And here I'll share with you a trailer of the game. It's a racing game in VR on Gear VR initially, and then other platforms hopefully after. We're launching it hopefully this month, so it's coming really soon. If you want to try the game, we have a stand in the VR area, so you can come and try it. It's quite fun. But what did we learn so far in probably 9 months of development working on this game, and maybe also the learnings we carry from before? First one is not all VR headsets are equal. So they're really, really different. Even on the mobile front, you think they're quite similar, but they are very different. Probably the biggest difference is around performance of these headsets, the capabilities they offer. So they are not all the same. You need really to test on as many as you can, or focus on a smaller subset to get the performance you want to hit. They all assume or pretend that they have native support for virtual reality, like plug and play, hit a button and you get the APK up and running. That's not always the case, so don't make any assumptions. Try to also test again here. Some headsets actually will surprise you that they're quite heavy. especially the all-in-one standalone headsets that come with everything, the display, the processor, the battery. Wearing them for quite some time will start putting a little bit of weight on your neck. So you want to think about, if you develop games for these headsets, how long the players will be wearing these headsets. So we think developing shorter bursts of gameplay is probably the way to go, rather than very long sessions where this becomes quite a problem. Since we are in mobile, then power consumption is important. The connected VR headsets like PC and console-based ones don't probably care that much about this, but mobile, there's a big concern. You don't want the smartphone to go, the battery to get drained really, really quickly. So it's a concern. Try to bear this in mind when you test and when you analyze the performance of your game. On the VR front, we notice also that not everyone likes the same content or likes VR the same way. So people have different opinions. And in VR, it seems to be even worse. So we tried to incorporate this in the game design. We didn't go for first person or third person behind the car like everyone would go for, but we preferred a side view with less camera movement to appeal to a far audience of people. This helped also solve in a bit the second point. Motion sickness is a serious problem in VR, and it seems to be worse if you move the camera in an unexpected way for the user. So things to avoid is moving that camera in an unexpected way. Try to give control to the player or the camera controller where they look as much as they can. And also a trick we found is that we don't have to be very, very close to the object, like first person or third person behind the object, but try to be a little bit far out. Like if you can imagine yourself watching a football game and you're really quite high up in the pitch. The height of the camera also can surprise you. So like in real life, we're not all born with the same height. Some people are taller than others. And in VR, you have to make a decision where you want to position the height of the player. Some people told us they feel like giants in VR, or others feel like they are quite short. So that's something to bear in mind. Try to adjust to maybe an average height, or you can give that as a parameter in your game to control. Use the 360 capabilities as much as you'd like. Wrap around the player as much as you can, because that's the whole point about VR. But do not overdo it. Do not force the player to look around like 360 to get essential things in the game done. So use it to advantage for immersiveness, but don't make it mandatory to get the gameplay going. Otherwise, it would be too much of going around and can turn into an unpleasant experience. Input methods and controls also were a little bit challenging, and it took us longer than we thought to get these right. We tried different things, and then the conclusion we got to is actually keep them simple. The simpler, the better. Our game uses only one touch to get the car accelerating and you release to decelerate. Providing options might be a good option if you want to incorporate better gameplay. Some headsets come with no input methods, so try to bear that in mind, especially the cardboard kind of experiences. And if you're flying in VR, we notice that turning the head left and right causes motion sickness, and it's much better if you're tilting the head rather than turning the head. So these are tricks that can help the performance. And the last point around artwork, it's really important you talk to your artists. If you're an artist, listen to me, the designers on this front. The artwork needs to be authored carefully in VR, because things are really, really close to the eye. And any sharpness can be really, really magnified in VR. Try to optimize the assets in terms like batching, joining the assets together, or compressing them. ASTC is a technique used in mobile, texture compression technique. Use those as much as you can, because it saves power, it saves also size in your device. So that's it for me. These are our learnings, and I'll be happy.